In order to really understand whether you're keeping up or living in the past, we have to get an idea as to what you're actually starting with. What do your assets look like? Because in a colocation space, in a colocation business, it could be really easy to think that it's largely about the real estate, that it's about the square footage, it's about the PUE rating, the certifications, the Uptime Institute rating, all of these things. And they do matter, but for different kinds of buyer personas, they mean different kinds of things. But what assets do you have that are helping you to attract the right strangers in the right places, in the right at the right time, and most of all, in the right context? Because in a traditional model where cold calling was effective, where spamming people was effective, where direct mail was effective, where there were much fewer channels, where it was a lot easier to catch people's attention, none of the stuff mattered as much. How many of you, when you decide to purchase a new product or service, one of the first things you do is go to a search engine and type a query? How many of you have actually used a search engine in the last 24 hours for something work-related? How many of you have used social media for something work-related in the past 24 hours, whether it's watching a YouTube video, looking at a SlideShare, asking a question on LinkedIn, tweeting something? So it's not quite as high. How many of you use any kind of artificial intelligence where you're asking questions of Google or Siri or Cortana or Alexa? These are things that are changing. And if we asked these questions 5, 6, 7 years ago, it wouldn't be quite as dominant as it is today. What's changed is the tipping points. Is if you look at even age groups and different demographics, it doesn't matter even if your primary ideal buyers that you're looking to attract are boomers. The adoption rate on search engines and social media, cloud, you know, it's fundamentally changed the way people are making these decisions. So are you positioned or not? So one of the things we want to look at is whether you're able, whether your funnel is actually robust enough. If you're have assets that are attracting the right visitors for traffic generation, do you have assets that are attracting the right kind of leads for a lead generation perspective? Do you have assets that segment those leads properly and nurture them? A lot of colocation providers' websites are basically set up in such a way that they think that the first time somebody comes to their website, they're going to take out their credit card or call up sales and immediately be ready to buy. And that's about as silly of an assumption as thinking that if I go into a car showroom this weekend to test out for headroom and legroom, that the car salesperson should assume that on my very first visit I'm going to buy. What happens if that person pushes really hard? They're going to push me away, right? The flip side is what happens when I am ready to buy if I go in there and no one's ready to help me. So it's really important that we not only know who they are and what they care about, but it's really important that we know where they are in the buyer's journey so we can personalize and contextualize our approach. Early on, people are asking questions about problems, about goals, about solving their problems, looking for answers. In the middle of the buyer's journey, they tend to look for a lot of comparison guides, buyer's guides, to help them weigh the different options. Towards the end, the decision-making process, then they're into looking at product-related information, information about your company. Maybe they'll sign up to take a tour. Maybe they'll sign up for a consultation, some kind of a free initial audit. But it's important to make sure that your assets are well-positioned to cover that entire funnel. Kind of the table stakes today is the website needs to be optimized, and it's not just about search optimization, it's optimizing for your buyer personas and a mobile dominated world. It's how many of you look at your website to make sure that it's mobile friendly? How many of you have looked at your website on your iPhone or Android phone recently to see how it renders there? Do you have to pinch and zoom, or is it nice and smooth? Is it responsive? It's not just about the user experience. There's a really important stakeholder that makes decisions besides users. And if Google sees that your website is not responsive, if it's not mobile friendly, it's going to largely penalize you, and it's going to favor websites that are. And it doesn't matter whether we're talking about ranking organically or whether we're buying paid through Google AdWords. Mobile experience matters a lot. There's another interesting thing that's being talked about as well with encrypting searches, where all websites will run on SSL. And that's starting to be something that a lot of companies are doing more of. We think it's going to be mainstream within a matter of 12 or 24 months, where if your website is not, even your public pages are not running on SSL, that you could be falling behind the competition that is. And that's certainly a very easy, very inexpensive thing to do. But it's something that people don't think about. They figure, well, it's not capturing sensitive information. Why would I bother encrypting the whole website? So the website's got to be optimized, having an active blog that shares educational content. It's very difficult to do content marketing if you don't have a content management system. Do any of you have websites that are still hand-coded and not on a CMS? It's a bear to keep the content fresh on a regular basis. It's a bear to delegate it to anyone else in your company. It takes a lot longer to really be able to get things out, and having fresh, active, updated content on your website is extremely important. Being on social media, kind of table stakes, and being realistic about what reach you have and don't have, and supplementing that with paid activity?
Yeah, Mike is
out. Mike is out. So being able to supplement that with paid activity is extremely important. Can it, you hear me in the back of the room okay? Okay, I'll walk around a little more. So if we're not realistic about what we have or don't have, it can be really difficult to know whether we can actually achieve that, because early on you can write fantastic blog posts, you can create fantastic ebooks, you can have a really compelling webinar, and if the right eyeballs aren't seeing that, it's kind of like if a friend opened up a fantastic restaurant, they didn't buy into a franchise, they didn't get an advice from everyone, they got a great deal on the commercial real estate, but the reason they got a great deal on the lease is because it's 30 miles off the highway in the middle of nowhere and there's no other stores in that strip mall. You wonder how long they're going to be in business if they didn't think through how they were going to get reach, how they're going to promote it. It's the same way with content. Half the battle with content isn't just creating stuff that people want to read, that educates them, that has the reaction of, wow, this is really good stuff. I've been searching for answers just like this for a while. It also and gets them to think of who are these folks, what do they do? That's what gets them to be interested in converting to a lead and allowing you to begin a relationship. So it isn't just about the content promotion. It's not just about the content creation, it's about the content promotion as well.